KETV NewsWatch 7, chronicling the stories impacting our community. Stories making a difference. Stories that matter to you. This is KETV NewsWatch 7's Chronicle.
That seat belongs to you, not me. I said, well, what was it like losing? What it was like losing. I like to serve, but the people—it's the people—it's their seat. They decided to put somebody else there.
And former Congressman Brad Ashford's now hoping you'll put him back in that second district seat. Good morning. I'm Rob McCartney. This is KETV NewsWatch 7's Chronicle. Between now and May 15th, we're dedicating our upcoming shows to the primary election. It's part of our year-long commitment to covering the issues and candidates running in 2018. Well, first, the second congressional district race. No particular order. We're starting with former Congressman Brad Ashford. Next week, we'll talk with his Democrat challenger, Kara Eastman. And the following week, current Congressman Don Bacon will be here. Now, this is somewhat familiar territory for Ashford. 2 years ago, he was defending his seat against then political newcomer, General Don Bacon. And now, less than 24 months later, the tables are reversed. Our camera was there in January when Ashford filed his paperwork to run again. It was just days after we experienced a weekend government shutdown.
The perception around the world is the U.S. is closed for business, that we're going to retrench behind our boundaries, and we just opened the door to China and Russia and other adversaries.
And joining me now is former Congressman Brad Ashford. Thanks for being here.
Rob, thanks for...
Absolutely.
Great to be back.
Absolutely. So let's start with the obvious question. Why are you running again?
You know, I love serving. 16 years in the legislature, and the 2 years I served in Congress representing this community in the state was, for me, as good as it gets. I love being a legislator. I love trying to bring people together on tough issues, and I miss my colleagues, quite frankly. I developed relationships with deep friendships that with Republicans and Democrats alike, and I miss them. I want to get back and continue to work for Nebraska.
Last election, Sarpy County was basically the difference maker if you looked at the overall picture. What do you plan to do differently?
Well, you know, I ride my bike over to Sarpy County on the trail. I'm just not going to come back. I'm just going to keep riding.
Okay.
Keep driving. I've never really felt that there was a significant difference between Douglas and Sarpy. Obviously, they developed in different ways. What I see is certainly we're going to have to spend time there. I enjoy going to Sarpy County. When I was in the legislature, I worked closely with the Sarpy County school districts. I enjoyed that. I have friends out in Springfield and Gretna. I enjoy going out to those parts of the county. I think we just have to be omnipresent, and you know, go to the coffee shops and talk to people and let it be known that I care deeply about them.
Let's talk about some topics here. Hot topic right now, gun control, huge issue. What do you think of allowing teachers to have guns?
I'm not in favor of that for a variety of reasons. I think most experts that, first of all, I don't think most teachers want to carry guns. Their job is to teach. I do think we can secure the schools, however, and I think, you know, for we can do that. We can provide grants to the schools. That'd be something I would be in favor of to help school districts cause their buildings to be more secure. I think it would be a great infrastructure project, quite frankly, to go into the schools and help the schools become more secure, single entrance types of things, and just make sure that the schools are more secure. And we have resource officers in our schools here. They're trained, they're police officers or have been police officers, and I don't see any problem in if trained to have a firearm.
Now, you talk about infrastructure, though, specifically with school security. A lot of the schools, most of the schools, you have to get buzzed in.
Yeah.
So what are we talking about, metal detectors, or what kind of infrastructure?
I think I've talked to students about metal detectors, and it frightens them a little bit, the idea of walking into a school with metal detectors. They have fear. I think we have to bring everyone together to figure out what the right thing to do is. But the federal government, I think, has a role here to provide. I was thinking the other day about instead of there's $15 billion for a wall in this budget, at least the president's budget. $15 billion, if we spread it out to school districts across the country, I think every single building in every school district, parochial, private, and otherwise public, could get some funding to help develop the right security. I think each district has to make that decision, But there can be guidelines that could attach to that money. But I favor grants from the federal government, investing in those schools to make sure that they're as secure as they can be. And we have to talk to the experts. They're the ones that know.
And Speaker Ryan actually said that he thinks it is more of a local issue than
yeah,
it is.
Yeah, but I think the federal government has a response. The problem with Representative with Speaker Ryan is, and I know him and he's a good guy, but he spent all the money. You know, with the tax cuts and with this last budget, it's very, very hard to do any kind of infrastructure. And that brings up a great point. In the last election, we're all for infrastructure, we're all for infrastructure. We had a bill on infrastructure when I was in the Congress. There is no money for infrastructure. They're talking about taking it out of the budget entirely. So that's not going to help the economy.
Right. The president actually laid out $1.5 trillion plan.
But no federal dollars.
Okay, no federal dollars. Yeah. How big of a concern is infrastructure for you? Our roads, our bridges? I mean, if you had to put it on a list,
I think healthcare is number one. I think education is a close second. Gun violence is clearly up there now and has been for some while. But infrastructure is right in the top five. Broadband, Nebraska has done some good work on broadband, but we could do a lot better. Wind energy, I noticed that Xcel Energy in Denver is doing massive wind energy construction in 10 states that they serve, obviously Mid-American Energy in Iowa, plus roads and bridges. Mm-hmm. I think it's massively important to invest in our workers, to invest in our infrastructure. Those are jobs that pay well and that are sustainable.
Yeah, but you got to put money up front to pay for that. Where does that come from?
I think when we did the federal government needs to put money up front on infrastructure. When we did the bill on the, and we've talked about the VA hospital bill, first time ever in the history of the VA with the passage of that bill when I left in December of 2016. Now we have a public-private partnership. About two-thirds of the money comes from the federal government, and a third comes from local investors, and we're going to have a new VA medical center that we've wanted for years. I think that model works for all infrastructure, where the federal government, but you can't do what the president's talking about, is a 5 to 10% federal investment, which turns on its ear the old philosophy on the highway system where it was 90% or 95% federal and the rest local. You can't shove everything down to the states and local governments yet. You really have to. But the real challenge now is with the deficit, which is going to double from the time I was in Congress, and it's a problem.
So what's your plan on the deficit?
First of all, I wouldn't have spent $1.5 trillion on a tax cut.
Gotcha.
We've got it, so we have to deal with it. We're going to have, I would have put much more focus on the middle class tax cut portion of it. I would have done a corporate tax cut, and I think we talked about it couple years ago, the number was somewhere around 25 or 26% that was being proposed, and that go to a territorial tax system to allow money to come back. The plan when I was there was to take about $170 to $200 billion of that money coming back and investing it in infrastructure. As far as the deficit itself, we're looking at estimated $1.2 trillion. The debt, the tipping point on the debt is close to, it's already horrific. But when we get over $20 trillion, which is where we're going to be, then it starts to be a drag on the economy as interest rates go up. And that, so any tax cut that was in the tax bill that we had, 80% of which did not go to the middle class, you know, is quite frankly going to eat up any kind of tax cut they're going to see.
Speaking of tax cuts, would you agree to raise the tax on any individual tax bracket or multiple tax brackets in light of what we're facing?
Well, I think clearly the upper 1%, there needs to be I agree with Warren Buffett always on that issue, that I think there has to be a tax on the top 1%. But I don't think that's necessarily the answer. I think that's something that would raise revenue, and it's a good idea. I don't like raising taxes, but I don't like cutting taxes. I always thought that cutting taxes, and we did it in the state level, we could balance the budget and cut taxes, was a reward for good government. And when you aren't governing well, clearly Congress is not governing well, you put a $1.5 trillion tax cut on the books with no real concrete way to pay it back, pay for it. That's dangerous. I know state government is different from the federal government, but to go as far as was gone with only about 20% benefiting the middle class, what would I raise taxes on? I think the upper, very high income.
Not the middle class,
you can't raise taxes on the middle class now.
I mean, that's what the fear is, though.
But they're struggling. They're struggling, and student debt is a massive problem at $2 trillion. I think we need to put a cap. There's a bill in Congress that my friend Joe Courtney has that would have put a cap of 3%. I believe it's 3% or a little over 3% on student debt. There are lots of ideas there. But no, the middle class can't pay any more taxes. And quite frankly, with the earned income credit needs to be expanded, there are other ways we could have allocated that tax cut at a much less cost to the middle class than what we did. I mean, we gave every single 80% of the benefit and every special interest in the financial services area, we gave them everything they wanted and more. When I was in Congress and I talked to our corporations here, corporate leaders, I said, where do we need to put the tax? Because obviously they have deductions that come off their rates. And it was a 25, 26, 27, that would make them more competitive. The deductions haven't gone away. We haven't closed many loopholes. So close loopholes, reduce taxes on the middle class. If you have to raise taxes at all, it'd be on the higher, very high income level.
I want to ask you another question on gun control. A lot of students are demanding change. They're walking on the Capitol Hill right now. People are tired of hearing about the mass shootings. They're tired of the threats on schools. Do you think this will only end with a change in the Second Amendment?
I think that within the my view is it within the, I've worked on, as you know, since 1988 when we introduced our first bill on, I guess it was 1989, our first bill on banning assault weapons in Nebraska. So it's been a topic I've been interested in, gun violence generally, and what always drove me crazy is certainly loss of life of kids, young people, but anybody killed with a firearm, and taking the ability of people who shouldn't have a gun, taking that away from them is very important. The law-abiding citizen should be able to purchase a weapon, but I think within the parameters of the Second Amendment, there's plenty of room to do a ban on AR-15s. There's plenty of room to do universal background checks. One of the challenges we always had in Nebraska, when I was there in the legislature the last time, we bulked up our mental health records so that we could get it to the NICS system, which is the FBI check system. There's plenty of room, but here's what I think the last few weeks has shown, and that is that the incremental approach to the gun issue, essentially dealing with mass shootings, for example, is not going to work. The people of the United States, you saw it with Dick's Sporting Goods over the last week, a couple days ago. First National Bank, very courageous act. First National Bank is the oldest banking institution in the state, the largest privately owned bank. That's pretty good stuff.
Okay. All right, we're going to take a short break right now. When we come back, we're going to talk more issues like national security and your Social Security. We're watching KETV News Watch 7's Chronicle. You're watching KETV News Watch 7's Chronicle. Joining me this morning, Democrat and former Congressman Brad Ashford, running to get his old seat back. Let's talk some issues briefly. National security, China, Russia, they're identified as two major threats to the U.S. What's your thought on how to handle them?
Same major threats we had when I was there in Congress and served on the Armed Services Committee. Clearly, Russia is the certainly without talking about North Korea for a moment, is the most significant threat to the United States, their end of the world, quite frankly, and their movements in the Middle East, in the Baltic, and in Asia. I think what was missing and is missing now is a clear policy, a clear authorization for use of military force, Congress chiming in on what our mission should be in the Middle East and in Africa. I know when the four members of our military in Niger that were killed, people were asking, why do we have troops in Niger? Well, we have troops in Niger supposedly to go after ISIS. I think that ISIS contingents. I think it's clearly ISIS is still out there in pockets. We launched the last couple of months of my term. We launched the offensive on Mosul. ISIS has its ability to operate in a single caliphate has obviously been diminished, but ISIS is out there. But the void that's being created in Syria is very dangerous. It's allowing Iran to move to the Mediterranean through Lebanon. So I think that's a threat to Israel. So I think a lot of the threats have remained the same. I would like to see Congress chime in on what is our mission. Right. Instead of simply passing continuing resolutions for military spending, the American public has a right to know what our mission is in the Middle East primarily, and in our fight against ISIS and extremist groups.
Would you vote to send more military troops overseas?
When I was there, I did support the effort to send more troops to Afghanistan, mm-hmm. and we enlarged the commitment there to 9,000. It's now 14,000. It depends on the situation, Rob. We're not going to have a massive 100,000 member force in the Middle East like we did with Afghanistan, nor in Iraq. It was another 100,000. Well, that's not going to happen anytime soon. I think the threats on the Korean Peninsula require that our presence remain strong there. But sending ground troops, massive numbers of ground troops, I don't see that on the horizon. But I do think Congress does have an obligation to pass what's called an authorization for use of military force, something that was passed in the early 2000s to deal with the issues in Afghanistan and Iraq. But I don't see a massive ground flow.
Let's talk Social Security just for a second. Privatization, for example. Mm-hmm. Would you be willing to allow people to divert some of their Social Security taxes into personal retirement accounts? I mean, a lot of people think they can do better than the government.
Well, we just went through a massive recession, a massive loss of assets for millions and millions of Americans that have put money in IRAs. I think Social Security is probably the best programs we have. We need to make sure it's sustainable. We have plenty of opportunities for individuals to invest in IRAs and other instruments, and we should encourage that. But no, Social Security is critical, especially for those individuals who have retired now and that rely on it. But even for future generations to have that available, I think is number one. It's good for them. It's good for the economy. We made a pledge to those people, and we need our seniors and even people. I know you get from 40, you think you're 40 or 35, you're never going to need it, or it won't be there when you get there to 65. But I think that's a function of making sure it's solvent. We can do that if we have the political will to do it. There are ways to do it.
Let's talk immigration briefly. You mentioned the money for a wall. You'd rather use that for something else. But
I'd rather use it for schools.
Yeah, but
country.
What about DACA? I mean, that's coming up. I mean, that's
well,
facing
us
right to
when I was in Congress, the most frustrating thing was not being able to have a vote on a pathway to citizenship for DACA recipients, but their families. What I use as a guide in looking at this issue is breaking up families, having government policy that results in the breaking up of families is not good for the country. It's not good for these young people. And I don't see DACA, a clean DACA bill coming up anytime soon. It's been used as a political, it was used as a political football when I was there. It should never be that. We should have a pathway to citizenship for these people, so that those individuals who were born here and their families are here, why we don't want to break them up. We want to keep them here. They have to obey the law, having family ties here, having worked here, gone to school here. The economy needs good people, and for the most part, certainly in this community. Our immigrant population is incredibly important to us. I strongly support a pathway to citizenship. I thought Lindsey Graham and Dick Durbin had a great bill. The 2013 bill on a pathway to citizenship was a good bill. I just see a lack of consensus on just about everything in Congress, and certainly DACA. DACA is important and it's critical, it needs to pass, but what I'm very fearful of is if we pass a DACA bill and that's it, it's done. We're all done with immigrants. No, we're not. Because what's happening now is families are being broken up in this community. It's wrong, in my view.
Let me ask you briefly, and we just got a couple seconds left. Okay. Affordable Care Act, 20 states, including Nebraska, basically saying the individual mandate is unconstitutional because Congress got rid of, the actual penalty has been repealed. Some say it could be the beginning of the end for the ACA.
Not in Nebraska. 88,000 people have enrolled in the ACA. The current enrollment period. Mm-hmm. I think we have to expand the ability. I'd like to see a Medicare option for individuals to be able to buy on the exchanges. So if you're unable to afford insurance, or if for whatever reason you want to take advantage of this sort of Medicare option instead of buying insurance from a private insurance company. I think there are two bills on that in the Congress. I support them. We have to work on the cost side of health care, but by using the Medicare option, I think you have more bargaining power. I like to see the ability of employers. I love what Warren Buffett's doing with Amazon, the idea that you can expand your employee base for healthcare purposes to such a significant degree, your bargaining power is going to be significantly greater. You're going to see a lower end cost. But as far as the ACA, this when I was there, I voted. It was every couple weeks we'd have a vote to get rid of the ACA.
Right.
Well, what did that? We don't. And now since I've left, we've had bills passed in the House that have. Voted on by my good friend Don Bacon, Congressman Bacon, is basically to repeal or get rid of the ACA without any real substitute. Okay. So,
all right. We're going to take a right back with some final thoughts. First, a reminder, your comments, they're an important part of the show. If you want to be heard, email those to news@ketv.com. Love hearing from you, and we'll be right back. Well, this is KETV News Watch 7's Chronicle. This morning, we've been talking with former Congressman Brad Ashford, a Democrat in the 2nd District, wants his old job back. Don't have much time left, but former Congressman, we want to give you a chance to make a final pitch, if you will, to your voters.
Thanks. Well, thanks, Rob. And as I just mentioned to you, I love being on Chronicle. I can't recall. I'm trying to remember how many Chronicles I've been on, but I've loved it. I've been talking to a lot of people throughout the district. And essentially what I'm hearing, especially from younger voters, is we've got to get the assault weapons banned, we've got to get the environment changed, we have to do this, and we need to do it now. And I agree, and I have some deeply held convictions about those kinds of issues. The environment's a massive issue. Leaving the Paris Agreement was a massive mistake. We need to ban, in my view, ban assault weapons. We need to solve the issues of health care. My response to a lot of our younger voters has been this, that incrementalism in and of itself is not the answer, but we need to find bipartisan solutions. When I went to Congress, I told my constituents that I would work in a bipartisan way, and I did that. I was one of the most bipartisan members. I would promise to do that again if I'm sent back. Thank you.
Former Congressman Ashford, thanks very much for joining us,
Rob.
This morning. You bet.
Thank you.
Again, next week we are talking with another Democrat candidate for the seat, Kara Eastman. And the following week, it's incumbent Congressman Don Bacon. So you can compare the candidates. We'll have all those shows online. They're at KETV.com. Just go to our homepage, click on the menu button, and look for Chronicle. I'm Rob McCartney. Thanks for watching. We'll see you back here next Sunday morning for KETV News Watch 7's Chronicle.